ask you all a question. If you were going to look for a new kettle, for example, where would you go? Would you go to a store or would you look online? My guess is probably that most of you would first of all have a little look online. Technology has changed the way that we shop, and that's from product discovery, like looking for kettles, to checkouts and home deliveries. We're going to kickstart this next session with a few minutes with Shopify's Chief Operating Officer. So please welcome to the stage Harley Finkelstein.
You're going to go on this closest edge. So that's just there, right? Oh.
Okay.
No. Can you hear me now?
Fine. Good. That's it. Which is the best one?
I think someone else is talking, right? Are they gone? I think so. So, welcome. My name is Harley Finkelstein, and I'm the Chief Operating Officer of a company called Shopify. Just by show of hands, how many of you have heard of Shopify or have used Shopify? Wow. I asked that same question here a couple years ago, and about half the room put up their hands, so that's incredibly flattering to me. So I want to start by talking about something really, really important, which is, what am I wearing today? This is it. This is what I wear almost every single day. And what I'd like you to think about is, what do all these brands that I'm wearing have in common? Every single article of clothing that I wear today and every day, I purchased from the people that actually make the clothing. They are all direct-to-consumer brands, and all of them have been created in the last 8 years. Now, this is not an accident. If you look at some of the clothing all of you are wearing, you will notice the same thing, that for the first time in a very long time, all of us are wearing clothing that we purchased directly from the manufacturer. And I believe this direct-to-consumer movement and these direct-to-consumer brands represent the entire future of retail. So today I'm supposed to talk about the future of retail. But I find it very difficult to talk about the future if we don't actually look backwards. And so I want to spend a few minutes looking back. It starts 10,000 years ago, the moment where modern commerce and modern retail was invented. People lived in a world of barter, where they exchanged goods and services for other goods and services. It was very, very simple. And then 1200 BC happened, and we had this massive piece of innovation. For the first time ever, currency was created. And now people were able to exchange goods and services for a token of reciprocal value. This was a really, really big deal at that time. The next piece of innovation in commerce and retail happened in the 1870s. And it happened in a place called Philadelphia, of all places. A gentleman named John Wanamaker created Wanamaker's department stores. Looked just like this. This was the first time in thousands of years that you as a consumer can go to a single place and purchase tons of different brands from tons of different makers. Suddenly, on the merchant side, merchants were able to have distribution. They didn't actually have to be in any particular place to sell their products to people all over the world. And my hypothesis is that over the last 150 years, there has not been that much innovation in retail and commerce. We've seen more stores that look like this. They're modernized, they're bigger, they're flashier. Some of these stores now have water parks in them. But for the most part, we've effectively have had the same department store model over and over again since 1876. Now, the reason that this model was a good model was because it provided three different unique value propositions to the three players in the equation. You had buyers that had choice and variety. You had retailers that were getting these products at a discount, which they in turn were able to go and sell at a profit. And you had makers that had an expanded market. This is the intermediary model. And this is effectively how most of us think about shopping and commerce and retail. And then came the 1990s. A lot of great things came out of the 90s, but one thing in particular changed everything: the internet. The internet's creation, for the first time in the history of business, democratized distribution. It allowed anyone to get in front of anyone else. So this is where things get really exciting. The internet introduced all of us consumers to this idea of e-commerce. But there was one major problem 25 years ago, which was that if you were a brand, you were a maker, you were an entrepreneur, it was almost impossible to build a beautiful online store. In fact, the original internet, original e-commerce, looked like this. Every major store looked the same, and e-commerce was built to take existing brands and make them bigger. It was not built for new brands to enter the market. And it cost about $100,000 to build one of these online stores, even though they didn't look very, very good. So it was a bad experience for consumers, and new brands had no chance of getting in front of buyers. But 15 years ago, something dramatic changed. New e-commerce software entered the market, Shopify being one of those. We were created to help brand new businesses and new entrepreneurs get to market for the very first time. And finally, online brands were able to build beautiful, unique, incredible buying experiences that attracted consumers with their own brand. So let's fast forward till today, 2019. Where are we at right now? In 2019, there are two distinct retail movements at play. If you are a brand, a maker, an entrepreneur, and you want to get your products into the hands of consumers, you have two options. Option one is you can use a marketplace where you don't have to spend much money, but you effectively have to rent customers or lease customers from that marketplace. In that model, you don't have a direct relationship with the customer, and you do not own the entirety of the profit margin. The other side is the direct-to-consumer side. You see Allbirds up there, one of my favorite brands, and the shoes that I'm wearing, where they can create a beautiful-looking website, they can bypass third-party intermediaries, they can own the customer relationship. So merchants, for the first time in the last couple of years, have been able to take back control of their distribution. The independent brands and the merchant movement has staged a comeback recently. And in this case, they removed a component of the system to allow the system to run closer, faster, and better. And thanks to the spread of social media and scalable technology stacks, people all over the world are able to build huge businesses that compete with the largest brands on the planet. What has happened is an entirely new value equation has emerged right in front of our eyes. And it's happened in the last decade or so. Buyers and consumers are now able to buy incredible products from incredible makers at an affordable price and interact directly with those makers. And those makers are able to control the entirety of the retail model and keep all the money for themselves to reinvest in the business. And this new equation is working. In the last 12 months alone, more than 218 million consumers have purchased a product from a Shopify independent brand. 218 million. In fact, if you take all the Shopify stores just in the US alone, and you were to aggregate those sales, we would be the third largest US retailer. That's a very big deal. Now, this retail trend is happening in Germany as well. Here's a little bit of a fun fact. When we look at consumers across all of Shopify stores, 175 countries, German consumers actually check out faster than anybody else. It takes on average 17.68 minutes for a German consumer to check out. That is faster than any other country on the planet. You guys are very efficient. But I've talked a lot about history on a stage where I'm supposed to talk about the future. The future is very simple for Shopify. We want to keep building products that make it easier for anyone to become an entrepreneur. And then once they become an entrepreneur and they become successful, we want to level the playing field so they can grow to become some of the largest brands on the planet. We want more of this. Currently on Shopify, every 52 seconds, a brand new entrepreneur makes their first sale. We want more entrepreneurs, more makers, and more direct-to-consumer brands taking off. So our place in all this, Shopify's role in this, is that we are here to support the authors of the new economy, the authors of the new retail model. Direct-to-consumer is not a fad. It will be steady state for the future of retail and the future of commerce. And we exist so that more entrepreneurs can play in this new economy. I'm really fortunate and excited today to welcome one of these authors of the new economy from a company called Gymshark. Please help me welcome Ben Francis and Ian Jindal from Internet Retailing for a conversation on the future of retail. Thank you.
Thanks, Harley. Well, look, a great introduction. You set us up incredibly well. Before we go any further, I'm sure most people here have heard of Gymshark, but maybe, Ben, just kick us off with a snapshot of the business. Mm-hmm.
So Gymshark was a company that I founded when I was 19 years old. At the time, massively into bodybuilding, and literally no one made the product that we wanted to wear. Everything was more of a big, boxy fit. We wanted things to be more fitted and really suit, I guess, the style that we wanted to achieve. I was working at pizza at the time. I bought a screen printer and a sewing machine and handmade clothes for 2 years, essentially. So just spent 2 years in the garage hand-making clothes. You know, we were some of the first people to really utilize social media in the way and influencers the way that it is today. We did events. We did events here, actually. We did FIBO all around the world. And, yeah, fast forward to last year, UK's fastest growing business, and yeah, it's just going incredibly well.
So there are lots of people in the audience who are working for entrepreneurial companies or starting up themselves. Just tell us the moment when it went from being you with your passion and your sewing machine to thinking, oh my God, this is a business. When did that happen?
So that was the first event we did. So it's funny because we're talking about online a lot here, but our real sort of explosion was offline. At the time, the company was turning over around £300 a day. We went to an event in Birmingham, which is our hometown where the company was founded. And we just smashed the event. We flew over YouTubers. We were the first people to do this. And it went viral on social media. We turned everything off on the website because everything was handmade at the time. And I remember posting on Facebook that the website was live again. And we went from £300 a day revenue to in the first 30 minutes of the website being live, we did £30,000. Everything sold out. And I was just sat there in my mom and dad's living room just thinking, oh God, I need to leave Pizza Hut now.
So look.
I love the story. I mean, it's amazing.
It's pizza's loss, though. Imagine how many pizzas you just sold. Mm-hmm. But look, you were talking earlier on, Harley, about this idea of a retail operating system, which is no longer e-commerce and store, it's everything, social, mobile, bring the brand together. Ben, when you look at your business, do you recognize that as a new approach, this sort of integrated, all-in approach to retail?
Absolutely. So like, obviously when you look at it, in terms of what we do, it is online. The vast majority of what we do is online, and it goes through our websites and social media. But I don't think you can forget that the core nucleus of our brand is the face-to-face conversations and communications that we have with our customers. It's so easy for you to look at the numbers on a screen, whether it's visitors to a website or likes on a post, and just forget that each one of those is a human being and an individual. And our brand is, obviously, it's online, it's on the website, it's on social media, it's on the events and retail stores that we do worldwide. It's an entirely immersive experience.
And we were talking earlier on about your commitment to social. Mm-hmm. So everyone now goes, blah, 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 social. Yeah, of course, we're doing Instagram commerce. But you were there right at the beginning, even before you knew it would work.
Yeah. And I don't want anyone to take this the wrong way. That was not a considered decision that where a group of people sat around a table and thought, this is going to really work. Growing up, our heroes were YouTubers, and it made sense when we were making this product that we'd poured our heart and soul into, it made sense to send that product to our heroes. They happened to be on YouTube. We sent it to them. They loved it. They started posting it, and the Gymshark family and athlete team was born there.
Wow. Now, you know, we talk as if we're talking about you specifically, but when we consider the whole ecosystem that you have, this is by no means unique. I mean, there is this increased integration. Mm-hmm. What do you think are the requirements for an entrepreneur to really own this friction-free, all-in approach?
I actually think what Ben represents is fascinating, because Ben is a modern retail brand. He's a modern company. And because he's a modern company that was sort of forged in the fires of the last 10 years, he's never really thought about it as sort of these binary channels where there's offline commerce, and there's online commerce, and there's social media commerce, and there's marketplace commerce. Ben never thought of it that way. Mm-hmm. In fact, for them, they've been fairly agnostic to where the product gets sold. They want to engage with an audience. They want to sell their products, whether it's online or offline or anywhere in between. And I think that is the advantage that Gymshark has over some of the major incumbents. The reason right now, and I haven't been in a Nike board meeting, but I'm certain that every Nike board meeting, someone is bringing up Gymshark or a brand like Gymshark as a major competitive threat to the Nike monopoly or the Nike, you know, oligopoly. And I think the reason that is the case is because Ben created a brand and said, let's engage with consumers however and wherever they want to engage. Mm-hmm. And by being channel agnostic, by looking at retail as an entire environment and not one channel versus the other, last year, Gymshark was the fastest growing company in the UK. Now, not to say another more established brand could not have done that, but the fact remains that he never had the bias or the biases. He never had the tools or the playbook to say, here's how we're going to do it. He's been making it up as he's gone along. And that actually is the advantage of the modern retail brand. And I think that's why Gymshark is kicking butt when it comes to relative to some of their peers who have been around in some cases for 50 years. Mm-hmm.
So for those companies who have been around, they're thinking, I just want to Gymshark my business. We'll turn it into a verb now. So if they came to you and said, what is this mythical thing? How do I do that, given that I'm starting from a siloed business? I'd like to ask you that first. What is it that's different about today's capabilities versus 10 years ago? And then in a second, it's just interesting to get your view for the inside. Mm-hmm. You've heard Harley big it up. What does it feel like for you to drive that? So firstly, what's new about the capabilities?
So there's one thing in particular that I think is worthwhile mentioning to this group here. We're at a tech conference. I think it's worthwhile saying this. What technology has done is effectively made the barrier to entry a lot lower, but also the cost of failure is trending towards zero. Mm-hmm. And I think what a lot of great brands, if I look on Shopify, some of the brands that I admire most, the Gymsharks, the Fashion Novas, the Allbirds, the Bombas, the Kylie Cosmetics, the Yeezys, brands like that, what I think they understand is that if they try something and it doesn't work, they're simply going to take the learnings, pivot, and try something else. Where I think there is far more of this analysis paralysis that happens with much larger brands. Ben tried a pop-up, and it worked, and so we did more pop-ups. But if it didn't work, you wouldn't have done it again.
Yeah.
It wouldn't have mattered. Because again, the cost of failure is so low. Now, the flip side of that is because it's less expensive for anyone to do it, you have more competition. But I think if you actually take advantage of the fact that you can try a bunch of different things, and you can pivot, or you can double down as those things work or don't, and simultaneously, I think if you have an authentic brand in the way that Gymshark has cultivated it, I mean, Ben wears Gymshark. I hang out with Ben all the time. He's always wearing Gymshark. Ben is always in the gym. Mm-hmm. This is not some sort of marketing ploy. He is authentically the person behind Gymshark.
But in a way, I think that's a difficult argument, because not all brands are authentic. So if you already have 10,000 staff and 200 stores, the cost of failure can actually be really, really painful. So the technology cost may be nothing, but if you've got to say to 10,000 staff, sorry, I messed up, would you like to get another job? That's actually tougher. So are you saying that the cost of failure has moved from technology to something else? Where's the real challenge now if the technology can do that?
So I think what you're alluding to is that it's a lot easier for entrepreneurs and small businesses to be nimble and innovate and try crazy ideas.
Yeah.
But that has not been the case of what we've seen on Shopify. So we talk about the Allbirds and the Gymsharks and the Fashion Novas of the world. We also have Procter & Gamble and Unilever and Johnson & Johnson using Shopify. And what we find fascinating is often what happens is some junior marketer in one of the departments at Procter & Gamble decides we want to sell this product direct to consumer, or we want to do a pop-up, or we want to put people's faces on Lay's potato chips. And it actually, the innovation in some of these big companies comes out of not the CIO's office or not even the CTO's office, but actually the marketing department. And then the ones that are really smart and thoughtful, they will build a case study based on that experiment, and then they'll go to the C-levels, they'll go to the executive and say, hey, this worked really well, we should try it in other departments.
But again, there's the challenge of failure. Let's have a quick poll in the audience. So a quick question, out of everybody here, how many of you are encouraged to fail by your company? Is there anybody here? We have one, two.
There's some Shopify people here, so that's somewhat unfair because we love when people fail.
Someone correct me. I think we're looking at maybe 10% of people fail, and the rest of you, is failure not an option? There's a lot of nervous looking people, no cameras on the faces.
But actually, Ian, I think the question's unfair. Show of hands, how many of you are encouraged to try things and see if they work or not? So I think that actually
That's a very good
there's
point.
More. Yeah, fundamentally, I think that's what we're talking about here, which is that a Gymshark failure and trying things out and being super agile is baked into the culture. Mm-hmm. At bigger companies, you almost have to convince someone that that's the way to do it.
So really, it's not so much the failure, it's the fact the inertia that stops you trying has been taken away. So Ben, you went from sewing machine, mm-hmm. pizza job, to
350 in the UK.
350 staff in the UK. You're just opening your Colorado office as well. Mm-hmm. So what was it like for you when you realized, God, this is serious business?
Yeah.
How do you maintain that authentic approach that you're driving the business as you have so many more people?
So before I answer that question, there's just one thing I wanted to mention on the last point. And I think as businesses grow, inevitably you'll have, particularly in market, and you'll have channel owners. And the one thing that I think happens is people become loyal to the channel rather than the consumer. And you have to have the ability and the guts to drop a channel if it's not working for you, if it isn't right, and just be able to be agile and move your investment between channels, depending on what really
and so
truly
serves the
customer.
How do you know that a channel is or isn't working? Because you know, you were saying earlier on how you were pioneering social media when at least four times it definitely didn't work.
Genuinely, I think a lot of it is gut instinct. We're heavily run on gut instinct, and I'll give you a story that sort of, I think, summarizes that well. Is 5 years ago was the point where we were taking the majority of our risks. Cash flow was tight, and it was a really tough time for us. It was at this point that larger companies were starting to put pressure on us a little bit more. And we had the idea we thought we weren't close enough to our customer. And we had the idea that we were going to fly all the way around the world to all these different cities across the US and Europe and Australia. And we weren't going to take any product to sell. So there was no commercialization of this project. We were just to meet the Gymshark customers and fans and talk to them. And we would go all around the world and we'd land in parks, just anywhere that we could possibly find. We didn't have a location or anything. And we spent months, some of the the top people in the business, just meeting the customer. And at the time, people were going, even in Gymshark, right? That's just crazy. Why would you do that? There's no commercialization. There's no ROI on this. To this day, there is not one activation or marketing activity that I think we've ever done that trumps what we did on that trip. Genuinely, the things that we learn about, when we were in Canada, we learned about the Canadian customers. We learned what the Americans wanted and, the differences in Europe. It was absolutely mind-boggling, just the amount of things that we learned through random conversations with Gymshark fans across the world. Like, I cannot, tell you the value that brought to our business and still does to this day.
Yeah. When you're hiring somebody mm-hmm. to come in, they're the 351st person, or you're so busy you're hiring a chief of staff or something, mm-hmm. what are you looking for in your next employee? What's the most important characteristic?
So obviously we want them to be humble. I think that's really important, especially because Gymshark's not had massively tough times, I would say, in terms of our growth trajectory has been incredibly, it's been like a bit of a hockey stick, and you know, long may that continue. So we want them to be humble with that. For me, ambitious, we want them to be disruptive. That's a word that we mention a lot in Gymshark, is we want to be really disruptive in what we do. We want to constantly think outside the box, and if there's ever a point that we are getting comfortable, then you always want to pivot and change that. Obviously, switched on and ambitious is huge. In terms of, genuinely, some of the best people that we've hired, and this goes all the way up to the CEO, because I'm not the CEO of Gymshark, I'm more in the marketing side of things at the moment, to the vast majority of people that sit on our board, they were hired with no job description. They were hired on the basis of, you're a really cool, ambitious, disruptive, humble person, and we think you can do great things, so we want you to own that area of the business. And that's just been, again, so valuable for us.
Right. Well, look, from my perspective, having been through a number of phases of e-commerce, digital, it's so exciting to see the combination of the technology capabilities increasing, the cost to try decreasing, and businesses like yours being able to just flourish. So it's such a positive story. Mm-hmm. But for the 20% of people who are out there trying and the 80% who want to try, let's just round off by words of advice. So let's start with you, Harley. If you were saying to the next Gymshark person out there, what are three bits of advice you'd give them briefly? Yeah.
So let me just say this, that I've personally been incredibly grateful to have been a part of the Gymshark story from day one. Gymshark started on Shopify at a kitchen table. Mm-hmm. And has grown to be one of the massive, largest brands in their space on the planet, and it's going to be on Shopify. So I'm really grateful for that. I'm grateful that you trust in us to do that. But one common thread about Gymshark and Shopify is that in both cases, Shopify is the product we ourselves were searching for when we were trying to sell snowboards. Mm-hmm. And Gymshark was the clothing you were trying to search for when you just wanted to work out in really great gear. Mm-hmm. And in both the case of Shopify and Gymshark, we both set out to solve our own problems. And I think that is something that gets said almost like an internet meme. You see it on Twitter as a quote, but people don't really understand that. I think some of the best stories across 820,000 stores on Shopify started out by someone seeing a problem and wanting to solve it. And often it was their unique individual problem they wanted to solve. And so I would encourage all of you that are thinking about starting your own brand or online store or retailer or any entrepreneur venture, think about something that actually you suffer from, something that is painful for you, and solve that first. And then be authentic about how you would use the product. Shopify is the product we were searching for. I think Gymshark was the product you were searching for. I would start there.
Great. So authentic, solve a problem. If you were giving advice, what would that be?
God, this is tough. One thing I would say, which is slightly off that, I think, is historically we've seen brands that can go out and they'll create a bunch of product to put in a bunch of retail stores to please a bunch of people. I think there's a huge shift currently happening in that, and you know that is led by guys like Shopify in terms of going direct to the consumer, because you totally understand in real time what they want. And I think there's a huge opportunity for everyone in this room to be a part of that huge shift. And I think all of the, I guess, the benefit of that is going to come in the years to come. Mm-hmm. I'm massively, don't get me wrong, we are led by data. We love the fact that we're direct to customer and we know exactly what's happening, whether what time our fans are lifting to what color of product they prefer and so on. But like genuinely, I think you really need to trust your gut instinct in things like this. And all the best decisions that we've made have been definitely gut led, albeit backed by data. And I think all the biggest mistakes that we've made have been when we haven't trusted our gut instinct.
So again, back to that authenticity and knowledge. Mm-hmm. Well, look, guys, a big thank you. I think it's an absolute privilege to see two people who are not only knowledgeable and driving businesses they believe in, but also willing to share openly and discuss with us. So I'd like to invite you all to say thanks to Ben and Harley for sharing their thoughts with us today. Thank you, guys.
A huge thank you once again to Harley Finkelstein, Ben Francis, and Ian Jindal. Now, Generation Z have grown up not knowing anything but this technological world that we live in. We discussed different ways to target the youth of today in our next fireside chat here on the Congress stage, so do join us for that in a few minutes.